Gospel of Thomas basically, I guess, saves the best for last, right? Kind of got my eye out here. I got a front door and a back door I can run out of if I need to. But this is a.
I'll start the car.
So, as I am wont to say, I don't try to lean into my own understanding when it comes to these things, that no scripture is of any real private interpretation. So I've given, in this sheet, I've given what I believe to be sort of ample basic evidence. There's a lot more I could have put in here. I could have gone into Adam and Eve. I could have gone into the Gospel of Mary Magdalene. There's various places where this this basic topic is discussed. But I wanted to give the most pertinent and the most direct ones. So the verse reads like this. Simon Peter said to him, "Let Mary leave us, for women are not worthy of life." And then Jesus responds, "I myself shall lead her in order to make her male, so that she too may become a living spirit resembling you males. For every woman who will make herself male will enter the kingdom of heaven." So a couple of things. Number one, we had already discussed in the Gospel of Thomas, and this pertained much more so, or at least more obviously so, to the Greek version, that some of the verses in the Greek basically don't exist in the Coptic, and they appear to be interpolated and stuff. It's not entirely impossible that this was just tacked on to the end by some other person, may or may not be arcane to the Gospel of Thomas itself, because the Gospel of Thomas itself seems to end at 1:13 anyway. When you look at it in the verse that says, "When will the kingdom come?" he said, "It will not come by waiting for it. It will not be a matter of saying, 'Here it is,' or 'There it is.' Rather, the kingdom of the Father is spread out upon the earth, and men do not see it." Basically, we talked all about that. There's a heavenly meaning. It's couched in the earthly meaning. And then if you say that the heavenly is spread out over the earth, that's basically saying in code that the earthly things that you read are spread out, and they each contain a heavenly meaning inside of them. They sort of encapsulate that heavenly meaning within themselves, that these heavenly treasures are housed in earthen vessels. In other words, that what you see on the physical level corresponds to that earthen vessel, and that that heavenly light, that heavenly meaning or whatever, is contained within those things. And so, in other words, the lower level meaning contains within it the higher level understanding, and that when you get eyes to see that and you get ears to hear that, then you understand parables, because again, he calls out, "Whoever has eyes to see and ears to hear, let them hear." You know what I'm saying? That kind of thing. Yeah. So you could have ended Thomas there, but it goes on to say what we just said. So there's a couple of things. You deal with this or do you not deal with this, and how so if you choose to. The issue is, okay, so again, I try to give it its context as much as possible. As you guys all know, and I hope everybody here has a copy of the Agrapha fully integrated. If anybody doesn't, they're on the back counter over there. You can pick yourself one up. And I urge people to listen to this in the audio format that I put it in.
Amen.
The reason I say that is because when I look at something from a sort of structural standpoint, like how it is that we have, based on all of the Agrapha, because what this was my efforts to gather from as many sources. Like, I go on the internet and I look up all the Agrapha over here, and then I go find another one and look up all the Agrapha in that book, and then I find another one and find all the Agrapha in that one, and then I would find, you know, just...
An Agrapha is like a statement of Jesus not found in the Bible, found in apocryphal texts or in other historical sources of the writings of the early church fathers.
So what I did was I took the section out that largely pertained to Thomas, where Thomas was embedded in the Agrapha that I put together, and I just sort of, where it kind of started to flow into that idea, as I gave you the beginning there, and where it started to flow out of that idea, I ended it there. But I'll just go ahead and read it really quick, just as a reading, so that you guys get a sense of where this is. But you'll notice over to the right, the sources are different. This is from the Gospel of the Egyptians, one place, the Gospel of Egyptians, another place. Thomas, the Egyptians, another place. Thomas, Clement of Alexandria, Thomas again. You know what I'm saying? So they're different sources that are coming together. How this happens structurally, I'll leave to your imagination, but I imagine there's a little something more to it than just chance. But if you read it as it says here, I'll just read it from beginning to end, because I'm only really going to be able to read this and just point out things, because it's not a world of time. But it says, Salome says, "Until when shall death have dominion?" The master said, as long as ye women bring forth. Salome says in another place, I did well then in not bringing forth. The Lord answered, saying, eat of every herb, but that which hath bitterness, eat not. In the Gospel of Thomas, he continues, if you bring forth what is within you, again, bringing forth, what you bring forth will save you, right? If you do not bring forth what is within you, what you do not bring forth will destroy you. And again, if the heavenly is couched in the earthly, if you don't give birth to that, you see what I'm saying? Then if you don't do that, you're going to remain in death.
What you don't know,
in ignorance, in other words, right? Because whoever comes to find the interpretation of these sayings will not taste of death. Therefore, death retrofitted means that you don't understand. It's based on ignorance, right? So he's using bringing forth metaphorically here, right? Mm-hmm. The Savior said, I came to destroy the works of the women, namely of lust, of the works, namely of birth, and of destruction. Now, what I would say just sort of parenthetically to that, if you think about it, again, like we were discussing earlier, we sort of are in this frame of mind of what they've come to term it presentism, which is another neologism. There's neologism after neologism after neologism because there's this whole push to do away with old ideas, quote unquote, you know, and progress to new. Well, yeah, okay, but as a cultural revolution, but the idea is that he's using this term, the works of the woman, to imply lust, because again, you know, because we are male and female, lust exists, right? Because of birth and of destruction. If you think about birth in a very metaphorical, very sort of loose sort of way, let's say that your intention was to couch the heavenly into earthly, and you were looking for something earthly into which to couch the ideas of reproduction, right? What would be the first thing to come to mind as a metaphor? I mean, what on earth in life brings forth other life? What on earth it brings forth death? Because death comes with life. We all die, mm-hmm. right? And we read this previously in the Gospel of Thomas a few verses back where it says, where is it? Yeah, in 101, it says, whoever does not hate his father and mother as I do cannot be a disciple to me, and whoever does not love his father and mother as I do cannot be a disciple to me. For my mother, and there's a lacuna, but I believe what it says is gave me death, but my true mother gave me life. So within this concept of mother and motherhood, there is both the bringing forth of death and there is the bringing forth of life, right? So the one does not include the other. It's not a categorical statement that women just represent death and death alone. They also represent life. You see what I'm saying? He's using the metaphor both ways. I mean, like, what if we just now read? It says, if you bring forth what is within you, again, as a woman, then that will save you. If you do not bring forth what is within you, that will destroy you. Again, that's the mother of the earth versus the true mother of the spiritual, right? So that kind of rips with that statement.
I want to mention something Paul says about giving birth. It's kind of interesting how Paul does not hold, it's very interesting, Paul does not hold Eve responsible for the fall. Mm-hmm. Paul's always blaming Adam.
Yes.
He didn't tell her.
Right?
He's in charge.
And the other thing
is,
God was standing there.
Another thing is, Paul says, I think it's in Timothy, that the role of a woman in giving birth, Paul says that women are saved. There's a salvific function, that they're saved by childbearing. So
and this touches on that, like,
right? That's, so Paul says that, you know, it's a redemptive act. You know, when, you know, Eve was deceived, she sinned, even though Adam's not responsible. But then Paul says that virtue of giving birth, women share in salvation. That's what he says in Timothy. Mm-hmm.
I did want to point out that when the baby is in the womb, mm-hmm. everything is provided for that growing person because that baby in the womb is a separate person. But everything is provided for that baby in the womb. And yet for that baby to transition from being inside the mother's womb into this life, there is all kinds of cutting off from life-giving sources to that baby. And that baby is on its own. So this verse that says, for my mother, and there's something missing, gave me death. It is a form of now self-sufficiency that, you know, either, you know, you make it or you don't make it. Those babies that are born out in the African desert, you know, they drop out of the mother and it's like, okay, You got less than a minute to get up on your legs and run.
That happens with the wildlife.
Yeah, fawns.
Right?
Yes. You see a new that actually happens. They're running. Yeah. The baby drops. And they got to get up and start running.
Right.
That's a lot. I'm sorry to take away so much of Robert's time, but I do want to mention there's a big theme in a lot of this extra biblical and apocryphal literature about the Gospel of Thomas. And the Acts of Thomas. This is the story how Thomas goes to India, and then you have the Acts of Philip. It's kind of interesting how women play a big role in these acts. And I think we're looking at Jewish culture, but it's not just Jewish culture that excluded women. Mm-hmm. And then what was the value of a woman? You weren't seen to have equal value with a man. Your value was twofold. One, in giving sexual pleasure to men, and two, in bearing children. And then, so that's your identity. So I mean, looking at this, women were attracted by the Christian message because it's liberating. Paul says in Christ there's no male or female, there's no Jew or Gentile, there's no slave or free man, right? We're all one, so it's a liberating, and I think that's why we see this theme. But in a lot of these texts, women are, in these apocryphal acts, they're identifying themselves as, they're renouncing sexuality, right? I am a human being, I'm a child of God, and to express my individuality, my service of Christ, I'm going to, renounce my sexuality. And of course, that's not something the Catholic Church maintained that tradition with, nuns and priests and things like that. That's not something very popular in modern society. But we see that, I mean, it's very interesting. That's a theme in various apocryphal texts. And sometimes women are coming in and that's how they're, and it's a theme. I can talk about that more later. Let's continue on.
So, but the idea is that we're talking about, you're born into...
Wait, Jonathan, you have a comment?
Yeah, I want to say that it was just every single culture in the world excluded women.
Mm-hmm.
Native
American, everywhere.
Every single culture in the world excluded women.
India,
and
Islam.
Yeah, and it's not just Christianity that began to pave the way, it was Judaism. Mm-hmm. And some of the things written in Torah are groundbreaking for women's rights that just before would not have been dreamed of. I think that they succumbed to the influences of the cultures around them and took more of the women's rights back away. But Torah itself was giving women rights.
Right. Just like having to give a woman the bill of divorce. And another thing to remember is like there are certain cultures that have more rights for women. But still, almost all cultures are still male dominant around the entire world. Before Islam, you actually had women ruling as queens and empresses over the Arabians. When Muhammad took a lot of rights that women enjoyed in Arabic society away from them. So this is Muhammad's own
agenda
and beliefs to oppress women. Because, like I said, you have matriarchal Arabian clans, women dominating, becoming chieftains.
Look at his
Muhammad
dating habits.
Did away with all that.
This is sort of tangentially related. It was sort of the culture, as was spoken of earlier, that women didn't really have a say in the church or in the the synagogues or whatever. That was unusual. Doesn't exclude the fact that there were prophetesses in the Old Testament and the New Testament. You see Anna, of course, and it's not unheard of that women could be heroes and stuff. I think we're kind of making perhaps the wrong point. I think everything here is always going to be truer on the metaphysical level than it is on the physical level, because the physical is always just a shadow. It's always just a representation. It's always just a type.
Amen.
And if you'll read the notes that I put out, you'll see that that's explicitly what's said further on. But the idea is that so I come to destroy the works of the woman, namely of lust, the works namely of birth and of destruction. Again, you're born into life, but you're also born into death. I mean, it's you have a life, but you also have a death sentence. It's a mixed bag, all right? The spiritual life is something that's not taken from you. You know, the spiritual body, the spiritual incarnation, our immortality awaits us. You see this with St. Stephen, who's transitioning into his angelic nature. You see this with Moses and Elijah at the Transfiguration. They are in their angelic nature. You see all of this stuff kind of pointed at, indicated in the New Testament. Mm-hmm. So when Jesus says that we will be like the angels in heaven, that we won't marry or be given in marriage, in other words, we're not going to be involved in the lusts and the birth and destruction like we once were. But again, he's speaking metaphorically, and if I could move on here, let me move on. So again, this isn't the context in which the statement comes up. Okay, let Mary leave us, for women are not worthy of life, because again, in the context of all of these seemingly negative statements about women and what it is that their function is in this world or whatever, he says that he shall lead her in order to make her male, so that she will become a living spirit. So in other words, he might as well be saying, I myself shall lead her in order to make her a living spirit, right? Resembling you males, for every woman who will make herself male will enter the kingdom of heaven. Okay, so the idea is the transformation from the physical, from the fleshly aspects, like we were just talking about, women in the flesh can't teach, women in the flesh can't, you know, whatever, that we are going to transcend that, that we're going to move on. And actually, I'm going to get a little bit ahead of myself, because I want to jump down to, this is on the same page. See where I have it written in purple down below? Where it says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water by the word. You see, in the deep structure, those are related. I myself will lead her, it says in Thomas 1:14, to make her male, right? He's transforming her, Mary Magdalene. And in the case of Ephesians 5, basically 25 through 27, it says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her by having cleansed her by the washing of the water of the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. Again, that corresponds to making her male or making her spiritual, in other words, because she represents the church.
Paul is using, you're saying, metaphorical, not biological language, well, anyway, right?
Because that's what he's saying. He's saying,
right.
He's saying that he, that she might be holy.
Spiritual knowledge.
But in Paul's case, he makes it clear that she represents the church, and that's what I was hoping this would lead up into. So let me go back to where we just now were. So after Gospel of Thomas 1:14 in the Agrapha, as I have it ordered here, logically, the most logical order I could put it in, it says, when will you become revealed to us, and when shall we see you? It says, when you disrobe without being ashamed and take up your garments and place them under your feet like children and tread on them, then you will see the Son of the Living One, and you won't be afraid. And Salome, inquiring concerning the things in regard to which he spake, should be known when his kingdom should come. The Lord said, when you shall trample underfoot the garment of modesty, again, the flesh, when the two shall be one, again, the spiritual. And when you see the spiritual in the earthly, now you're seeing on two levels, not just one. Mm-hmm. So the two have become one to you, because they're no longer, you're no longer separated from that truth. So there is no longer that division between you and the other. So now the two have become one, right? And then that which was without as that which is within. The idea is that the goal is to get you. You are part of the church, right? And so the whole heavens and the earth or whatever are related to that. The entire context of your reality is also geared towards the movement of basically having Babylon implode on itself and its own nonsense and its own, because nobody buys it anymore, and then having this to be replaced by God's eternal church, which is us. So they fall and we get raised, right? The weeds get bundled up and burned, and the righteous shine forth, right? In that order. So right now we're seeing Babylon, the cracks and whatever, and it's just about to implode. And this is the idea, is that an understanding of the truth is going to make us male, is going to make us spiritual. Because we are the church, we are Mary, we are the female, all of us. We are all the bride of Christ.
We're the body of Christ.
I'm not ashamed to be called the bride of Christ if that's the metaphor that he chooses to use. Right? Because it's not on the physical. It's on the spiritual. It's on the metaphysical. Right? And so he says, and when you make the male, neither male and the female with the male, neither male nor female. And it says, the next one, again, from the Gospel of Thomas, says, when you make the two one, and when you make the inside and the outside one and the same, and the above like the below, in other words, the heavenly is couched in the earthly, right? The whole world or whatever is geared towards your inner salvation, right? All of those things correspond and correlate to, in order to get us to that point, right? And then it says, and when you make the male and the female one and the same, so that the male be not male, nor the female female. And we'll read a little bit later, because I have a little quote from Clement that explains this more fully. But the idea is that we're not here any longer to be perpetuating ourselves and our own fleshly teachings and or whatever, right? That we're here then to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Right? So, and then that's what it flows into. And when you fashion eyes in place of an eye, you see on two levels now instead of just one, right? And a hand in place of a hand, in other words, now you're no longer doing your old works, but now you're doing new works, right? And a foot in place of a foot, now you're no longer walking the path that everybody else walks, now you're walking a different path, right? And when you make the likeness in place of a likeness, you're no longer seeing things on just the lower level, but you've raised it up to the heavenly level, and now you're seeing it with your other eye. You're hearing it with your other ear, in other words, right? Then you will enter the kingdom. And that's pretty self-explanatory, because if you now understand what he just said, you're now a child of the kingdom, and you've been transformed by the renewing of your mind, if you might say by the washing of water, right? Which is to say the word. Right, which leads us into Ephesians. Again, let me skip down really quick to verse 32. So Ephesians 5:32, because I want to use that as the lens of explaining everything else. It says, "This is a great mystery." I think is what it says in the King James version. But it says, "This mystery is profound." I'm saying that this refers to Christ and the church. Okay, so everything in this section is leading to that point. So let's go back and read it with that lens. Okay, it says, "Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord." So husbands and Lord are being kind of conflated.
Yes.
"And for the husband is head of the wife," and by way of analogy, "as Christ is head of the church." Mm-hmm. So the husband and Christ are... they're like keys for one another. You see what I'm saying? So when he speaks of the husband, he's speaking parabolically about the Christ.
Yeah.
He's speaking parabolically about himself. And so, and it says, "For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit everything into their husbands." Because again, the wife is the laity, if you will, the congregation, if you will, and the church in that connection basically corresponds to leadership, right? So the laity is essentially expected to fall in line with the leadership, provided that the leadership is in Christ, right?
Right.
So in other words, so long as the husband is holding up his end, metaphorically, the husband, right, the leadership, right, is an accurate representation of Christ, then the laity,
right,
which is the wife, should be in submission, because to do otherwise would be sedition within the church, which is not something that he's urging here.
Right.
It says, "Husbands, love your wives." So now it's a little bit on the man, right? "As Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her." So a husband is supposed to be self-sacrificing.
Yeah.
So if your husband in this world, you see what I'm saying, is self-sacrificing, then it's proper that you should fall in line. If he's given himself for his family, he's given himself for you, you know what I'm saying? It should be symbiotic, right?
Yeah.
Is what he's saying. But he's not just speaking about men and women. He's speaking about the Christ and the church.
Right.
So in other words, if we understand the truth, the way, the truth, and the life, if we come to walk in that way and in the truth and in that life, right, and walk by the light of that world and not the light of this world, mm-hmm, right, then we're being subject. See, as the wife, all of us,
yes,
I am the wife, the bride of Christ, if that's the case, right? So why should I not be in subjection to my true husband, which is Christ, right? So it's not about what the way the lines are drawn. It's about the way it's spoken of metaphorically and symbolically. And it's clear when you see that. You can actually see what I'm saying if you follow it. So what's the transformation of the church? "That he might sanctify her," that is us, right? Having cleansed her, that is us, by the washing of water with the word, right? Which is this. You see what I'm saying? So that he might present the church to himself in splendor, right? So again, he's just transmuted what he was saying, husbands or whatever, he just transmuted that into church. See how he did that without any kind of transition? He just did that. You see? So that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, so that she might be holy and without blemish. And what did we just read in 1:14? I will lead her, the Logos, the Word, the washing of water by the Word. Jesus is the Logos, right? In order to make her male, right? In order to make her what? Spiritual, a living spirit, right? Holy and without blemish. You see the parallels between those two things, right?
Yeah.
So if you consider that Mary Magdalene in this case, if you see the deeper connection, if you're seeing that there's a connection between her and the church in that phraseology,
yes,
right? And if you recognize that, then you kind of understand why seven demons were cast out of Mary Magdalene, because this is the seventh day, and all of that demonology is gone, right? To touch him not, because he has not yet arisen. You see what I'm saying? So in other words, the church is going to be alienated from the true Christ until the time of his coming, which is the seventh day, which, you see what I'm saying? A lot of things fall into place when you see it with this logic, right? What is the symbolism here? Okay, so and it says, in the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, right? For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church. Again, so the analogy just keeps being made over and over and over again, right? And because we are the members of his body, in other words, we are him, he is us, you know what I'm saying? There's going to be the unification of us and him,
yeah,
because our thoughts will be his thoughts, our words will be his words, our actions
right.
will be his actions, our paths will be his paths. You see what I'm saying? It all just flows around in itself,
right?
And it says, therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Right? And it says this mystery is profound, right? For I am saying that it refers to Christ and the church. And then look at the word however. So in all this time he's talking about the church and stuff. But by the way, just so you know, you still follow in line, because again, this is, even though I'm talking about the church, I'm also talking about you guys.
Amen.
You see what I'm saying? So it's kind of a by the way
universal.
There.
Amen.
You see what I'm saying? Because he is talking about greater things. And so the next section, I just kind of want to read this real quick. Now, my first introduction to the second book of Clement was, I think, through the lost books of the Bible and the forgotten books of Eden. And I was always sort of dismayed at the fact that in that particular version, it was cut off. Like, it literally cut off here in chapter 12. It didn't really quite even finish the thought. And then I was really pleased to find out years later that there actually exists the entire document, just not in that particular volume. And so I left out 13 because it didn't pertain as much, and I didn't want to just...
I'm going to make it real short. Yeah, first and second Clement. Clement's mentioned in the Bible. He was a disciple of Peter and Paul, right? Mm-hmm. First Clement and second Clement, probably written around the year 95 AD. If you read them, which I'd recommend. And they were canonized for a while, both first and second Clement. And I think in Egypt, second Clement was part of their New Testament for a while. But these were people who knew Peter. They think that they might have had two authors, but it's attributed, they're both attributed. Scholars believe first Clement is authentic, that Clement, the disciple of Peter and Paul, wrote first Clement. Second Clement is a sermon. It's the oldest sermon we have. And if you read first and second Clement, they don't have access to the Gospels, right? They're still relying on oral tradition, direct preaching they received from the apostles themselves, not consulting. And with Second Clement, he quotes what we consider apocryphal Gospels as if they're part of the Bible. So it's interesting. But you can check them out, read them yourself, like Robert
well,
said.
Well, that just underscores that was kind of their early understanding. But I know you guys can all just read this, but for the sake of anybody who might be watching this on YouTube, I'm just going to kind of read it straight, maybe make a comment here or there, but I'm just going to try to just focus on, this is supporting evidence, this is just reiterating what we've already talked about, but I think 2 Clement is just, it serves as an excellent witness to what I'm saying, because he's literally saying exactly what I'm saying. So starting with 12, it says, "Let us expect, therefore, hour by hour, the kingdom of God in love and righteousness, since we know not the day of the appearing of God. For the Lord himself, being asked by one when his kingdom would come, he replied, when the two shall be one, and that which is without is that which is within, and the male and the female, neither male nor female." Like, we just got through reading that,
right?
So he's accepting that verse, right? And where was that verse? Probably out of Thomas, or possibly whatever Clement's quoting. But I mean, he's validating that scripture, number one, right? And this is a church father who, like the doctor mentioned here earlier, was also accepted in early canon, you know, representations that we have, right? It says, "Now the two are one when we speak the truth to one another, and there is unfeignedly one soul in two bodies, and that which is without is that which is within." He means this. He calls the soul that which is within, and the body that which is without. In other words, that which has form, external, right? Your flesh, your body, is really outside of you, because once your body's gone, you still exist, right? So in a sense, you're outside of it. You're apart from it. And then when you speak the truth to one another, and there are two bodies, remember we talked about that. These are encoded to be decoded, right? So when you speak the truth from this age to the next age, from one generation to another, and those two are in agreement with one another. And again, they have to be in agreement, because if you can decode it, it was because it was encoded. And so the two things are identical. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So that's what he's getting at there. So you have one soul in two bodies. Early church and the ultimate church are one in terms of the way that they agree with one another, right? And that which is without, as that which is within, he calls the soul that which is within, the body that which is without. "As then your body is visible to sight," again, body is external, you know, you can see your hands or whatever, you can't see your face or whatever unless you look in the mirror, but "so also let your soul be manifest in good works." Again, replace an eye with an eye, an ear with an ear, hand with a hand, right? Foot with a foot, right? Replace all that, right? And the male and the female, neither male nor female, this he says, "as brother seeing sister may not have any thought concerning her as female, and that she may not have any thought concerning him as male," right? The idea is that he's come to undo the works of lust and all that, like we just talked about earlier, right? To raise our sights from the level of the flesh to the level of the spirit, in other words. But again, on the level of Christ in the church, the idea is that the laity and the leadership or whatever should not be just a thing unto themselves. You know what I'm saying? But conform to Christ and the church. You see what I'm saying? So it's not just a matter of consensus. It's not just a matter of union. It's not just a matter of agreement. It's a matter of conformity, right? And it says, "If you do these things, then the kingdom of my Father shall come." Which, if you think about it, if you have eyes to see, you can give other people eyes to see. If you have ears to hear, you can give other people ears to hear. If you have a heart to understand, you can give people a heart to understand. You see what I'm saying? And then he'll help you. You know what I'm saying? He'll pour out his spirit, remember, on him in those days, right? And then that's going to fall down upon human beings at some point in the not too distant future. But again, as we see the world crumble, the foundations, right? This strikes at the foundations of religion as well. This strikes at the foundations of the church as well. See, it's pretty radical. But then again, if you move on to verse 14, it says, "So then, brethren, if we do the will of our Father God, we shall be members of the first church, the spiritual, that which was created before the sun and the moon," right? Because it was always there. "But we, if we shall not do the will of the Lord, we shall come under the scripture which says, my house has become a den of robbers. So then, let us elect to belong to the church of life," right? So there's two churches, the church of life and the church of death. My mother gave me death, but my true mother gave me life, right? See, the church is the one, right? "So that we may be saved. I think not that you are ignorant that the living church is the body of Christ. For the scripture says, God created man male and female. The male is Christ and the female the church." I think he explicitly says that.
That's a universal metaphor, right? You think of Israel as the bride of Yahweh and the church, congregation, the faithful.
So he will lead Mary Magdalene or the church, right, to make them male, right? To make them Christ, to give them the mind of Christ. You see how that works itself out. It says then that the books of the apostles teach that the church is not of the present, but from the beginning. For it was spiritual, as also was our Jesus, and was made manifest at the end of days in order to save you. Right? Which again, in his day, that's probably what he's referring to. But again, if you have the living church at the beginning and the living church at the end, you see what I'm saying? It's from one to another, the same thought, the same heart, the same mind, the same understanding. It's from generation to generation, from age to age. So when you read that from generation to generation, it's not like just empty words. It's very specific. And it says, for the church being spiritual is made manifest in the flesh of Christ, signifying to us that if any one of us shall preserve it in the flesh and corrupt it not, he shall receive it in the Holy Spirit. For this flesh is the type of the Spirit. No one, therefore, having corrupted the type, will receive afterwards the anti-type, which is to say the antidote to the fleshly thought, right? Which is essentially the new eyes and the new ears and the new hands and the new feet and whatever. Therefore, is it then that he says, brethren, preserve the flesh that you may become partakers of the Spirit. If we say that the flesh is the church and the Spirit Christ, then it follows that he who shall offer outrage to the flesh is guilty of outrage on the church. Such an one, therefore, will not partake of the Spirit, which is Christ. Right? Again, Christ level, earthly level. See what I'm saying? Which is the Spirit. Right? Such is the life and immortality which this flesh may afterward receive, the Holy Spirit cleaving to it, and no one can either express nor utter the things which the Lord hath prepared for his elect. And again, for 2,000 years this wasn't known, so it was unable to be expressed. And it was, you know what I'm saying, it wasn't spoken of. And here it is right in your face, so obvious. You know what I'm saying? All you have to do is put it straight. Like, what did John the Baptist say? You know, make his way straight. Right? Take all of these stains that are all over the place and just make it straight. Which is what that agrapha is. See what I'm saying? It's all these things gathered together and laid out straight, right? And then once you do that, then the high places, which is the people in power, will be made low. And the low places, the people that are downtrodden, will be made high. And everybody will be on par with one another because the truth is the great equalizer. It's not us, it's the truth. It's not the church, it's God. So that's a very valuable insight. Again, you can find this Second Clement, right? And it's even weird how it's hidden, because not all things that you can find online even have this ending. So they don't even have this verse. And I'll just really quick, I'll jump over where it says in Enoch, but it just as a witness, I included Enoch here, a little room at the end of the page, and I threw this in here. It talks about the waters that are above and the waters that are below.
Yeah.
Right? The waters that below, if you think of waters as scriptures, right? This is what we have in our possession. This is what we understand. But then there's higher level teachings that are above, right? So essentially they're separated by what we call a firmament, this metaphor, right? It has to do with those things which are heaven and the heavenly and those things which are earthly, right? Because we apply an earthly understanding to the scriptures, that de facto makes them earthly, because we're corrupting them with our corrupt thoughts.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? So we corrupt them. And so in this particular instance, he's referring to them as feminine, but he talks about that they're going to be mixed, that they shall be joined with those waters. So those scriptures which are above, or those teachings which are above, or the logos which is above, shall unite with, right, that which is below. You see what I'm saying? And so it is masculine, therefore spiritual, that unites with the feminine, which is in this case earthly, right? The cycle of birth and death. But again, it's symbolism. But it's symbolism that exists even in the book of Enoch. It's symbolism that exists in the teachings of Paul. It's symbolism that exists in the early writings. It's symbolism that exists all over the place in the scattered words of Yeshua. See what I'm saying? Everything comes together, and when you make his ways straight, you see what I'm saying? You just go down the line, and it's self-explanatory.
Amen.